All right, so my talk is going to be on XLA, which stands for Accelerated Linear Algebra. And that's a compiler we built for the sort of dense linear algebra you commonly find in machine learning models. And I should say that I'm presenting work done by many different people on the XLA team. So XLA is developed as part of TensorFlow, which is Google's open source machine learning framework. And TensorFlow relies on a concept called kernel fusion, and I'll explain what that is and why it matters for performance a lot. And yeah, so TensorFlow, in a sense, is like an interpreted language in many ways. It's a runtime and can't do certain optimizations that compilers can do, and that motivated the building of XLA as a compiler for machine learning. One of the interesting optimizations it does is automating the kernel fusion process, and that's where we get a lot of performance out, and this is the topic of the talk. All right, so a few words on TensorFlow. TensorFlow uses a data flow graph to express its model. So what you see here is a visualization by a tool called TensorBoard. Details don't really matter. So what happens here is that data flows along the edges. The data is multi-dimensional arrays, or tensors, as they're called. And once all the inputs to one particular op gets available, the runtime will take care of this and start up the processing. It's fairly common for these operations to have implementations for multiple backends. CPU and GPU is the common cases, such that TensorFlow can offload heavy computations to an accelerator if you have one available. All right, so throughout this talk, I'm going to use a running example, the ResNet model used for image classification. It's a fairly popular convolutional neural network. And I'll explain how this model is being compiled using XLA. So if you zoom in far enough, you'll see that the ResNet model is made up from blocks, and you'll see the individual TensorFlow ops in that block. And this is what I did here. So if you're a machine learning person, then you may know some of these operators. So I'll walk you through this real quickly. The ReLU up there is just a fancy machine learning term for maximum of the input, or zero. The add is just what you would expect, element-wise addition of two tensors. And then there's some bigger blocks down here, convolution. Without giving you much details, convolution is a thing that slides a filter over an input image to find patterns, and batch normalization is a clever trick to speed up model training. So it has been shown that if you normalize your input data to have a mean of zero and a variance of one, then your models converge faster, and batch normalization just does that within your neural network. And so you need a bunch of basic linear algebra operations to do this, and they have all been put into one kernel, and this is where the name fused batch normalization comes from. So fused kernels are very commonly used by TensorFlow, and they have a few advantages. So for one thing, they're convenient to use. Rather than having to remember how batch normalization is implemented internally, you just use one op. That's easier. But they're also very important for performance, because they run much faster than a combination of basic operations. And since that might not be completely obvious, I have an example here. So imagine you wanted to multiply a tensor with a scalar and add it to another tensor. You could do it like this in TensorFlow. Just use a TF multiply, TF add op, job done. Now, if you want to offload one of these operations to your GPU device, the code might look something like this. This is CUDA, C++, used for NVIDIA GPUs. And the idea here is that the body of this function is being run by many threads on the GPU in parallel. So each of these threads will grab one piece of data, multiply it with these constant, and write it back to memory. In CUDA grid, these threads are they're called launch grid. So all the threads that run are a grid. Inside this grid, you have different blocks, and each block has a dimension. So to figure out the index of each individual thread, you can go ahead and multiply the block ID with the block dimension at the thread ID within the block, which is done here. And this is the piece of input data that your thread is going to process. For the add, this looks very similar. All you need to do is, yeah, you just take two tensors and do the addition. Easy as that. So in what we've done here is we read and we have four tensors, read and written. Now, the memory bandwidth is your scarcest resource on the hardware accelerator. Your job is almost always memory bound. So a great way of speeding up your models is just reducing the number of memory operations you have to do. And here's a straightforward loop fusion where we use just one CUDA kernel to do both the multiplication and the addition, which will reduce the numbers of tensors read and written to 3, which is a 25% reduction. And given that our computation is very likely memory bound, this is a 25% speed up, which is really nice. But one thing that you can see here is this is not transparent to the user. So we had to register a fused multiply add operation. So the optimization here is actually on the user. So there's a but here. These fused kernels need to be, somebody needs to write them. It's still fairly common for them to be handwritten by high performance computing experts. So there's a development cost that's non-trivial. Then these fused kernels are inflexible because if they do what you need them to do, that's great. But if you need something slightly different, you might be out of luck. So if you're dealing with an open source framework like TensorFlow, you might be able to tweak the underlying C++ implementation, but that has, again, a development cost. And very importantly, these things are black boxes, so there any attempts to optimize them automatically are very hard. So what XLA seeks to do is keep all the benefits but remove all the drawbacks. And this is the idea to do this is to just automate the kernel fusion process completely. So this approach has been working pretty well for us. What you see here is a plot of relative speedups and slowdowns of TensorFlow models with and without XLA. Since these models are internal and different teams at Google gave them to us, I had to strip all the names, so you have to kind of take this at face value, but I'm not holding anything back. So this is each bar represents one benchmark that we use to evaluate our compiler internally. And as you see, in extreme cases, we get a really nice speed ups of 2 or 3x. And in most of the cases, we get still a very good speed up. Some of the models perform worse, and we're constantly looking into reasons for this. So here's a thing from a public benchmark. This is the MLPerf benchmark, which is a broader suite of benchmarks for different hardware and software vendors to compare their machine learning frameworks and hardware accelerators on. For TensorFlow XLA, we submitted a result for the ResNet model. The results are on the right here, measured as a speed up relative to your reference implementation. The fastest submission was from NVIDIA using a model called MXNet, and TensorFlow plus XLA was about 2% slower, which is not much. And given that this benchmark was very visible, we can reasonably assume that a lot of manpower was put into tuning these models, and we're still happy that we could generate code that is at the level or close to the level of what human experts would write. So, in the remainder of the talk, I'll follow through with the running example. So, here's how XLA ties into the TensorFlow ecosystem. You start with the TensorFlow model that's in Python, and this will generate a graph definition. The TensorFlow graph can now be executed by the TensorFlow runtime. But rather than doing this, we try to carve out interesting pieces of dense linear algebra and lower them into XLA's IR. XLA's IR is called HLO, which stands for High Level Optimizer IR. to distinguish it from different IRs that are more low level, like LLVM IR, for instance, that we're using for code generation. On the XLA HLO, a number of passes, compiler passes, are performed. Some of them target independent, some of them target specific. And on the optimized HLO, we will use, we'll lower this to LLVM IR in case of the GPU backend for the NVPTX backend to produce the code we run on the accelerator. So parts of the fusion logic happens here, and this is what I'm going to talk about next. But yeah, here's a brief overview of how HLO IR actually looks like. So it comes with operators for, yeah, mostly linear algebra, simple things like element-wise math, or more special math for neural networks like dots or convolutions. It has operators that allow you to reorganize your data, reshape your tensors, or broadcast them along different dimensions, and some control flow, like while loops, things that help you to transfer data in and out of your XLA computations. So for XLA, all the data types are known at compile time. It supports primitive types, just what you would expect. So you have floating points at different position, or composite types, multi-dimensional arrays, tensors, and also tuple types that allow you to return multiple values from one operation. If you decompose a TensorFlow op into HLO IR, it's typically a lot of ops, because this is a more principled IR and has less overlap. So to give you an example of this ReLU thing we looked at before, this is how it would look like in HLO, in a graphical representation. There's also a textual representation, but I figured this is better for to put on a slide. So what happens here is it takes one parameter as an input, the root is a maximum function, and this compares it to the constant zero, which is broadcasted to match the dimensions of the input parameter. So yeah, each operation has, each of these blocks has an operation, a type, and a shape, which is the dimensions of the output tensor. Cool, all right. So now that you, once you took all the TensorFlow ops and decomposed them into HLO IR, you're going to end up with a soup, sea of nodes representation. And what you want to do next for code generation is find interesting subgraphs in there that you can emit code for that runs a GPU kernel. So your overall goal by doing this is always to reduce memory bandwidth, because as I said before, by saving memory bandwidth, you easily, most easily get to speed up on memory bandwidth bound kernels, which is the very, very common case. So in general, fusing more operations is better, because you can keep the data in flight, do more compute with it before it has to touch memory again. But we're operating under certain constraints. So for these, for ops to reasonably be code-gen together, you need them to be a good fit for the same CUDA launch grid. So they, the loop patterns should match up. And we also want to make sure that memory access is coalesced, because if it isn't, then we're going to make poor use of our memory bandwidth. So at the HLO level, you can think of fusion as some kind of graph transformation in which you want to carve out these interesting subgraphs for code generation. And there's three things that the XLA compiler does at the moment. So one thing is simple producer-consumer fusion. And if your producer happens to have multiple consumers, you can still do this by duplicating it. So now you carry out the same linear algebra twice, but that's not necessarily a problem if it still helps you to save memory bandwidth. So on the left-hand side, you see A reads one data, writes one tensor, writes one tensor back out, and B and C read it, that's four. On the right-hand side, we replaced this with reading A's input just twice. Now, depending on the relative size of A's input and output and how many consumers it actually has, that might actually pay out. A different thing that you can try is something called sibling fusion. So if B and C kind of match up and you can code them together, you can put them in the same fusion to share reading A's output. So you cut your memory bandwidth requirements in half by doing this. The fusion node would have a tuple type that it returns, so it has both the return values of B and C in it. And the last thing you can try is fusion with multiple outputs here. We simply plump through A's output such that C can take it from the multi-output fusion. All right, so we'll see examples for all of this in the running example, and we'll start with how XLA fuses and codegens the ReLU op and the add op together. So lowered to HLOIR, this will look something like this. So don't get confused, these different visualization tools turn the data flow around, so now data flows from top to bottom. If you have something like this, the XLA emitters will first generate a parallel loop, as you saw it before, and make sure that we don't read out of bounds. So the size of the loop is determined by the shape of the root element, maximum in this case. And now we need to generate the code for the actual loop body. And here's how this works in XLA. The idea is that you have a generator function, and that generator function will return a function again, which returns an LLVM value given an index in a multidimensional array. So what I have on the slide here is the maximum case. Maximum takes two operands, left-hand side and right-hand side, and it needs the LLVM values for this in order to lower it to LLVMIR. And it obtains them by calling their respective generator functions. So it's kind of a chain function call that's going on here. If the value for some of these operands has been code generated before, there's some caching going on, so it's not going to happen again. Once both of these LLVM values have been code-gened, the next thing that's happening here is we'll emit a floating point comparison and a selection to return the right value. So back to the example, by calling the generator on the root, we would first call the generator on one of the operands and then call it on the roots, and this completes the example. The cool thing is this also works fairly well for really large fusions, and, where these recursive calls just kind of keep bubbling up and the code is being generated. So one thing that I want to put out on the right-hand side here is, not sure how well it's visible, but there's a lot of small parameters, just vectors that are broadcasted along their dimensions to become really big tensors, but this is free here because all what happens in these broadcasts is that we do an index manipulation. So we're not actually consuming any memory bandwidth for this. So there's some other interesting operations that dictate a certain iteration strategy, like a reduction. Because if you want to compute a reduction, then it's a good idea to tile the data and make each thread read one of the tiles, do a partial aggregation first, a partial sum in this example here, and then sum up the partial sums as the last step. What's nice about this is that each input piece of input data is still only read once, so we can use the familiar generator pattern that I just introduced to code-gen this. So here's an example for the sibling fusion with multi-output case that I introduced before. So you have two reductions, both computing sums. One makes the sums of the squares, and the other one just the sums of the raw inputs. That's what you need to do batch norm. And as you see, because the aggregation dimensions match up and so do the shapes of the inputs, it's fairly easy to generalize our code gen strategy. We just compute two sums here and return a tuple with two values in it. So we save on memory bandwidth. And yeah, here's another example that generalizes this case even further. So at the roots, you have three reductions. Again, the dimensions line up, so we can code-gen them together. But there's another little arrow coming in from the side. So that would be an example of this third pattern that I showed before, because we want to plump through some of the intermediate results, because a downstream op still needs this. So no need to recompute it again. And we can do this by generalizing the code generation in this reduce emitter a little further and using the inner loop to compute an extra output that is on the side. So, and this is what happens here. Again, there's some caching going on, so we're not going to code gen the same thing twice. All right, so I should probably also say that the actual reduce emitter implementation is way more complicated than this, because it takes care of warp communications and things like vectorization and the usual things you do to speed up your implementation, but this is just for the sake of a simple example. All right, so if we come back to the running example from the beginning, this is how the ops that we looked at would look like after they've been lowered to HLOIR and fusion nodes have been crafted. So what's interesting to see here is that we were able, or XLA was able to optimize across these machine learning primitives. So the fusion node on the lower left has parts of the ReLU, parts of ED, parts of both batch norms in it. Basically, XLA made a fused batch ReLU ed thing for us, which was exactly what we needed for this particular model. But we probably wouldn't have bothered writing this by hand. Another cool thing is that operations like convolutions are often very dependent on the right input layout of your data, and they also need the data input to be divisible by 4 or 8 to be very efficient. So you want to pad your data, or you want to transpose it before you feed it into these calls. And if you use fusion, much of this comes cheap or almost for free, because you can just fuse these transposes and pads into the fusions you would form anyway. All right, with that, I want to conclude my talk. So. If you're interested in our work, there's some documentation online. There's a public mailing list that we monitor and are happy to answer questions on. And the code is open source in the GitHub repository with the link here. All right, so I want to thank you for your attention.
All right, any questions? Yes.
Yeah, you were doing some splitting of divergence kind of stuff. So when do you stop? Because your graph is already large, and you are creating more blocks out of it. So what kind of heuristics do you use to control that?
So the question is, when we stop fusing, because fusing
No, the question is, you have graphs where edges are coming out, and you are duplicating that, right, to create more opportunities for fusion. So already your graph is large, and you are creating more blocks out of it. So what heuristic do you use to control? Because otherwise, it will kind of explode.
So yeah, if you go too large with fusions, you may increase register pressure. So we also have a threshold in there, a heuristic basically, to not go over a certain point. If that answers your question, I mean, the duplication itself is not bad because as long as we are, if we want to optimize for memory bandwidth, then we have enough of compute on the accelerators typically. So
okay, thank you.
This is not our problem.
Thanks for the talk. So my question is more like a follow-up. So can you explain like how do you decide whether a fusion is benefit? Like how do you decide it in general?
Yeah, so in general, we do, memory bandwidth and kind of the amount of data you'd read and write back out is the guiding principle. So as long as you can reasonably, as long as you can drive that down, that's good. But there are certain things that you would not want to do. Like for instance, if you fuse in a transpose that makes your memory access pattern non-coalesced, then you'd rather not do that. So there's a few heuristics in the code that prevent fusions from growing so large that they're no longer efficient when they're lowered.
So basically, there's like multiple heuristic, but the memory bandwidth is the primary one, right?
Yes, exactly.
Okay, thank you.
All right, that looks like it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.